So before we get started, you were in a movie in 1958. I think it was featured there slightly, High School Confidential.
Yep.
Where, I would like to point out, you said this line. You were undercover, I don't want to spoil the film, but Russ pretends to be a high school student, but really he's an undercover cop. He looks like he's 14. But you have the line, "I'm looking to graze on some grass."
Yeah. And I found it.
John Drew Barrymore was in that movie, and he told you a story about his dad.
Yeah.
And this hotel.
Yeah, about his dad, John Barrymore, and he said that he was in the hotel there, and that's what made me think about it. And he was at the bar, and he got drunk. He got really drunk, and they had to kick him out, and he was belligerent, and they finally threw him out, and he fell down on the sidewalk out in front of the hotel, and he looked up and saw that his star was there. I thought that was a great story.
That feels like a very classic John Barrymore story. Now, you caught a little glimpse there in that first thing of a film you made called The Fastest Gun Alive, where you're walking on the shovels.
Yeah.
And it's you do about a 3.5 minute number in the middle of that picture. And 5 years ago, 6 years ago, it went viral on the internet, right? As people discovered it, and it caused millions and millions of people suddenly watching this 3 minute clip from a moderately obscure mid 1950s film. And the reaction to it among a number of celebrities was through the roof. Steven Weber, who's on Wings, a great, terrific actor. Russ Tamblyn, amazing. Sarah Silverman, oh my God, watch it all. Really funny comedian Paul F. Tompkins, this is insane, right? All in caps. And then finally, the capper from an actress named Amber Tamblyn. My dad is a badass, full stop.
That's good.
Must be nice. I sense from a lot of stars of your generation whose kids might not be in the business, or even some who are, that you know they don't always have a full appreciation for their parents. But you and Amber, you guys share that. She likes to watch you work.
I do too.
did. But nice. You have a nice appreciation for each other's gifts.
Yeah. Yeah. That dance on shovels, by the way, Glenn Ford tried to get it cut out, an executive at MGM told me that he came up just ravaged and said, "Listen, I'm making a nice, simple little Western here." And they really, that's all I did in it was that dance. And it was sort of like in all Westerns, there's usually a section in there that's away from all the action where chorus girls are dancing or something on the stage. And so they said, you know, they asked me to do a dance number, and I did that number. And then, but Glenn said, and suddenly, you know, in the middle of my simple little black and white Western, this guy comes and he's dancing all over the barn and flying everywhere. And so they did cut it out for the first preview. But what they couldn't cut out of the preview was that in the credits at the end of the movie, it said Russ Tamblyn's dance number choreographed by Alex Romero. So luckily, when people filled out their cards after seeing the movie, they said, "Where was his dance number?" Because it said, you know, danced by Alex Romero. And so that was a good one for me anyway, to put it back in.
And there's no trickery. There's a couple of edits in it, but there's a seesaw, there's a couple of little bits on the seesaw where you jump and a girl flies through the air and you catch her. It's amazing. And then another one where somebody jumps down from up top from like a railing onto the thing and you go up onto the railing.
I mean, yeah, it looks... I know. I even now look at it and wonder, how the hell did I do that?
Yeah,
I did another trick in Seven Brides where I got kicked out and I grabbed a rope and climbed up it. And it was on the side of the board, and I was able to flip over the top to get to the top. And I still don't know how I did that. I think when you're performing, you get an extra strength.
It has caused millions of people, including serious fans of these movies, to think of you as a dancer. And obviously, you do dance, but that you're you're a gymnast, really, and a tumbler.
That's really what I was, as a gymnast and a street dancer. I, you know, just loved to dance, but I didn't take lessons or anything. And I wasn't supposed to dance even in Seven Brides for Seven Brothers. Michael Kidd wanted all the brothers to be, except for Howard Keel, but he wanted the rest of the brothers all to be great dancers, like Jacques Dambois from the New York City Ballet and Mark Platt. And so anyway, I wasn't even supposed to dance in it. And the studio said, look, you can have
four
great dancers, and then two actors that, we're leaving Howard out of this, but, and then two actors that are under contract here that'll just be acting parts. And I was one of those actors, but I happened to go on the set when they were rehearsing, and I went with Jeff Richards, and we went over to meet them all and see them all. And Michael Kidd asked me and said, I understand you can do you're an acrobat, you could do flips. And I said, yeah, and I right on the spot did a backflip for him. And he said, oh my God, we're going to put that in a number. And I said, no, I don't want to dance with Jacques Dambois, New York City Ballet. So I finally did it and told people, I guess that was on the screen too, that I told people that I was not a dancer and never had lessons. But I did have on-the-job training with all these great choreographers.
Right, Hermes Pan and Michael Kidd and obviously Jerome Robbins, yeah. So, and there's a photo of you, right, with your first wife in Beverly Hills. Anybody can look it up. It's one of the most insane photos ever going to see. Yeah, how did that, it was like in Look magazine or Life magazine, something
like
that.
Yeah, it was a full page of a photo, and we shot it. It was for Life magazine, and we just made it up when we were in Beverly Hills, and they were shooting some pictures of us. So I said, I got an idea, and he got in front of me and in front of Venetia as we were walking down, and I came down from back and did a round off and a backflip. And I sort of spread my legs a little bit that looked like I was walking. So the photo was Venetia and me upside down with my legs looking like I was walking. And so many people asked me, said, was that photo? And I said, no, it was a real
no, of course.
Shot.
Yeah, that wouldn't happen. And I can't do it justice, but she's walking like this. Like, God damn it. He's up here. He's like 5 feet over her head, upside down. His legs are spread like he's walking. It's unbelievable. Yeah, and all you did was just, you were winging it.
Yeah.
And you're on the sidewalk.
And on a sidewalk,
did you ever,
yeah.
You know, did what that, happens if you don't?
That's why I can barely walk now.
Did you, there must have been times when you failed to stick the landing.
Failed to what?
Stick the landing. Did you ever, you know, not land on your feet? Did you ever fall?
Once that I can remember, I was doing the Cinerama movie.
How the West
Was Won?
The
Wonderful World of Brothers Grimm.
Oh, that one, yeah.
And they did it. They did a shot. George Pal did a shot and wanted me to roll down this window, roll down this hill when I fell off a coach. And then he wanted me to leap over the camera. So I did that. I rolled and then jumped and leaped over the camera, and I caught my foot on the camera, and so landed and got a little banged up. But that's about it in dancing. I don't think I ever.
So, but that indicates to me that, like, so you do a thing where you run, and you know, most of us, even in our primes. Well, I'm still in my prime, of course, but some of you people probably aren't. And no, but you run and you jump up in the air and you get yourself 10 feet in the air upside down. You never had a fear that this doesn't end well.
No, I never did anything that I really had fear of. I did one thing in the Wonderful World of the Brothers Grimm where I had to roll down, and he wanted to get a double to do it. And I said, no double can do what I can do.
Right, right.
So I had to roll down and jump on a coach that Yvette Mimieux was riding in as a princess. And so I rolled down and then at the last minute jumped on top of the coach, but I had a round top even. It wasn't even like a, you know, a flat surface, but I jumped on top and then we continued the.
I think the answer to this question must be no, but it just occurred to me as you were saying, no, did you ever Were you ever asked in a movie that you were in to do any stunt work for another actor? Was there ever a bit that another actor couldn't do when they think, well, Russ is right here, he could do it, we'll just shoot it from a distance, give you a wig, and you'll look like somebody else?
Yeah, I think so. I mean,
all right. That, yeah.
You know, I mean, I never counted them or looked up, but I mean, I did that a lot. In fact, a stuntman told me, he said, when we found out, you know, whenever I did a movie, he said, when we found out you did a, that you, when you did a stunt, that you were going to be on the movie, that we all said, well, we won't be doubling him.
Right, of course, right, yes, of course.
Because I could have been a stuntman.
Of course you could have been a stuntman, yeah. I think you've made the right choice. You did a little better than stuntmen, who obviously do not get sufficient respect.
But there is a scene in Seven Brides for Seven Brothers that's at the end of the barn dance number when we're building the barn, and it falls down, all the walls fall down, and all the brothers are in the center. And that's when they used a double for me. And I mean, all I would have had to done was stand there.
You were never good at standing, Russ. That's what
that's
what I heard.
That's one of my worst scenes.
I can't just be there. this started for you in an unusual way, correct? Who discovered you? Who's responsible for your that first break?
I think the first one that discovered me was I did a play at the Cornet Theater on La Cienega. And it was directed by Lloyd Bridges. And that's when I was like 10 years old. And it was for a play that he was starring in it. And I played a young character in it. And I think I was about 10. And that was my first job. Now I'm 88, so I mean, it's a good, I spent some time.
And that that led, being Lloyd Bridges, that led to your first movie role?
Yes, an agent came and saw the play, and I signed with him. And then also a talent scout from Paramount saw it and brought me over to audition for Cecil B. DeMille. And so I did this... I did a scene with another actor who was under contract at Paramount, and there was a big glass thing that DeMille was behind, evidently. I didn't know, but I figured he probably was because it was all like glass. And we did the scene, and DeMille came out with his cane and his riding crop and his boots and said, "You got the part, boy." And that was the beginning of a good part. In Samson and Delilah, I played young King Saul as a boy. And
DeMille, though, could be tough on a child actor.
And I had one really tough time. I wondered where my mother was at that time. I was only like 10. But I did a scene in front of all of these people that were in the stadium where I had to run up to Samson, who was Victor Mature, and I had to walk up to him and grab his arm and say, "You know, we can get out of here. I've got my slingshot on my head." And, you know, I said, "I've got my slingshot on my head." And the camera was over here. And DeMille came over and said, "Russ," he called me Rusty. He says, "Rusty," he says, "don't, when you point to your slingshot, point back here because I can't see your face." And so then we started again, and DeMille was really a character. He had two people that walked around with him all the time. One had a chair, and every time DeMille wanted to sit down, he would just sit, and that chair better be there. It was always there. And then he had another guy that held a microphone, and as soon as he would talk, the guy would hold the microphone in front of his face. So anyway, we did the scene again, and I forgot. I just screwed up again, and I did the same thing, and I got my slingshot on my head, and he came in and he grabbed my hand, and I said, "Put your hand here, not here, but here," and he sort of banged, and he was pissed off, and I was really upset by it, because the guy was holding a microphone, and it went all over the stadium, so every extra, there were like hundreds of extras that all heard this, and I started to cry, and then they stopped for a minute, and finally you know, we did the scene again, and I was sure to do it in the back of my head. It taught me a lesson. That's
he needed a third guy, a yell at a kids guy. Yeah. Yeah. Follow him around all the time. I think they knew he was a character with the, he came out with his cane and his riding boots. Yeah, I think that's a sign that maybe, you know, because he wasn't doing any riding, he was directing a movie.
No, but he, yeah, but that's the way he dressed.
Yeah, well, all right.
You probably know that.
Yeah, but we'll leave. We'll leave it there on DeMille. The boy with the green hair, right?
That was actually the first movie that I
yeah.
did.
Yeah, so that was...
came because of the Stone Jungle, of Lloyd Bridges movie.
Right.
I went to see the director and auditioned for a couple of parts, I think. And then finally, I was almost like an extra in it. I did a part in it. But I did, on that movie, which was pretty wild, I became good friends with Dean Stockwell, who played the boy with green hair. And in fact, we lived together for a couple of years, 2 or 3 years, we lived together in Laurel Canyon. And
but this is when you were adults, like you.
Yeah, when we were adults.
Right. Yeah.
And but when we worked on the film, one of the things I did is there was a scene in The Boy with Green Hair where they cut his hair off when it's green, and they cut it all off. And I grabbed a bunch of it and stuck it in my pocket. And years later, on Dean's birthday, I put it in a birthday card, his green hair. And then another thing that was pretty funny about that was that when we were living in Laurel Canyon, we drove down to go to the market one day, and we stopped at a red light. And I looked over, and this car pulled up next to us, and there was a young teenager in there with green hair. He had his hair tied green. And I punched Dean, and I said, "Dean, look. And so Dean looked, and we were both staring, and the guy looked over at us, and finally he rolled his window down, and he said, "What's the matter with you? You've never seen green hair before?" <That's all right>. And I didn't want to tell him, yes, as a matter of fact, this guy was the first one to ever have green hair.
Yeah. Yeah, funny story. You're saying that to the wrong people. Yeah. You were friends with Dean all his life, yeah?
Yeah, and we did like 3 or 4 movies together.
You obviously had a great deal in common, sort of both becoming child stars. I know you were friends with some other child stars, including Robert Blake, Bobby Driscoll. You guys, what was that like? I mean, you know, we talk about this at TCM a lot, the difficulty that child stars have moving on to become adult stars. I'm starting to think that that has very little to do with talent and a great deal to do with a sense that maybe you don't even want it.
Yeah, I mean, I remember one time that there was Dean up in Topanga Canyon, Dean and myself and Bobby Driscoll and Robert Blake, and we were Billy Gray.
Right.
And that was pretty strange that we were all talking, and we never talked about movies or about our childhood. It was always other subjects. So it was pretty incredible. It wasn't until I wanted to do a book on Bobby Driscoll, because he had such a strange life, and he was such a troublemaker in a way, because he got on heroin. And imagine that Walt Disney's first person that he signed under contract was Bobby Driscoll for a movie called Song of the South, I guess. And so it's pretty bizarre, and I think they tried to cut his name out of everything. But
and he was a good actor too.
He was a good actor.
Yeah, he was some talent there. But his life was troubled right from the start, even before he became a star, right?
Yeah, from a very young age. I wanted to do a story on him because it was so bizarre. Bobby did a movie called The Window, in which he was nominated for an Academy Award. And the movie starts off with the camera, comes up and goes into this abandoned building, and then goes down the hallway and into this room, and there's Bobby on the floor. He's sitting on the floor, you know, and he pulls around and he does that like he's playing gun, you know, and he And then when he actually died in New York, he was caught when they found him, he was in an abandoned apartment building, and they didn't even know who he was.
For a long time. Yeah.
So I mean, that was pretty crazy.
So what is it that you, because your thoughts have gone, you've gone back and forth on the experience of being a child star. Like, is it good? Is it bad? And then all of a sudden, right at the moment that you think maybe it's not a good idea, you have this enormously talented daughter who wants to be an actress.
My daughter, yeah. But I wasn't really a child star. I was a child actor. You know, I just did parts. I never started. Well, I guess when I was about 14, I did a movie called The Kid from Cleveland. That was the first time that
you were featured.
Yeah. So it somehow didn't get to me as much as it got to so many other young stars.
But I think it's interesting that both you and Dean like stepped away from it for a while. Like
that's very, not only for a while, but for a long time.
For a long while, yeah.
In fact, it was Dean that introduced me to my wife, and. So that was really the beginning.
How did you, what was your pickup line to Bonnie? I like your pickup line.
Oh, yeah. I had a pickup line. I said, how would you like to learn how to dance?
That's pretty good coming from Russ Tamblyn. That's not bad. Yeah, it worked too, right? Yeah. How long you guys been together?
We've been together almost 40 years.
All right, well done, well done.
How about that?
After, say, the six, Seven Brides, and then that's really, whether you're a dancer or not, people start thinking of you as a dancer. You do Father of the Bride, Spencer Tracy, right?
Yeah, he was my father, and...
Joan Bennett. Yeah.
And then I did another movie with her sister, with Constance Bennett, was my mother. So in movies, I was my own first cousin.
Such a great line. How did you find Spencer Tracy, and how did he find you?
I was blown away by him. I mean, the scene, we were on the set, and before Tracy came on, and then he came on the set, and he was kind of scratching his head and walking around, and what's going on here? And I remember, and then he said, well, step over here. And he said, but what's the line? What's the line coming? Yeah, and then what do I say over here? And I thought, oh, my God, we're going to be here all day. And then so finally he says, okay, do you want to rehearse it one time? He said, no, let's just go for it. And so they said, action. And he just went, wow, boom, boom. And he did the whole thing just so fast and so quick. He had such a great sense of being an actor, and his advice was always be on time and learn your and know your lines,
hit your marks, know your lines, be on time. That's right. Yeah, that's good advice. Yeah, for everything. That's where you did you meet Elizabeth Taylor there, or were you, did you already know her from school?
I knew her because I was in school with her on the at the MGM schoolhouse, right. So I knew her from there, and her last on her 18th birthday. In fact, she graduated there, and there's a picture of Elizabeth with her cake, and it was a graduation party. And the teacher was had this dark hair with a part in the middle and tight little thing. She was like she was casted out of Central Casting, you know. And she was a real teacher, and she. And she was great, and at her party, they were taking pictures of her, MGM, and they went outside and they wanted to take a picture of her, and then they took a picture of her throwing her books up in the air like, you know, I'm through with school now, and the teacher came screaming out, said, stop it, she came screaming out. And she grabbed the guy's, grabbed his camera and tore the film out and said, you will not take a picture of Elizabeth throwing her books in the air. I always thought that was funny.
No, it's great. Yeah, of course. Yeah, you throw your hat in the air. You're not done with books. You can read after you get out of school. It's allowed. No, I was just curious, after Seven Brides, which I think was 54, right? You guys would know, right? 54. Whether you wanted to do movies that did not require you to dance, to tumble, whether that led to doing a film like Peyton Place.
Well, like I said, I was, before MGM, I did a couple of Westerns and, you know, I'd been working.
No, I know, but after Seven Brides, you had some clout, you had some heat behind you.
In fact, I was on the cover of Dance Magazine, I think.
I was also on the cover of Dance Magazine, that's so weird. Yeah.
Yes, which was pretty wild, and I always wanted to do more than just dancing, because dancing, I wasn't, you know, just a dancer. I mean, I was an actor. When Peyton Place came along, the director, Mark Robeson, sent me the script and said, MGM has given me permission to have you in the film, because it was a big, big film, Peyton Place. And so he said, pick out any part you want. There were a lot of parts of young people, and which part would you like to play? And so I read the script and I saw all the parts and everything, but the one part that really got to me was, and it was so unlike me, was Norman Page, who was just a really very shy mother's boy. And so I combed my hair forward and did it, but I had a great a scene in it at the end where I go into the Air Force and meet Diane Varsi again on the train, and she and now I've become a soldier, you know, and I combed my hair back and became so anytime you can get a part like that where your character changes or grows or something is, and I got nominated for an Academy Award, which was pretty amazing.
Did that feel like, did it feel like validation? It must have felt great.
Well, to tell you the truth, I think I was too young, really, to get nominated. I was only like 21 or something. I was pretty young. And I think I would have appreciated it more if it had come, you know, in another 10 years or something, but it never did. But
but 10 years later, you were living in Laurel Canyon and, you know, making collages. And
maybe 10 or 20 years later, right.
Yeah. So did you see West Side Story on Broadway?
I certainly did. I not only saw it on Broadway, but just fell in love with it then and wanted to do the part of Tony, which was the Romeo part. And I even learned the songs from it, from Something's Coming, you know, I learned that. And but I was still in the Army when I saw it. I went to New York on leave and I was in the Army. And when I came back and found out that it was, that they wanted me to audition for it, for the part, I think that was the one time that I went and auditioned. And I played the part of Tony in the auditions. I auditioned with several actresses. And oddly enough, I had the same agent as Robert Wise did. And Robert Wise was the director and producer of the movie. So I used to, you know, call Phil Gersh, and who was my agent, and say, you know, how's it going now? He says, well, they're still looking at people. And I said, but you're right up there, you know, they're thinking of you. And so finally, one time, I called him up and I said, I'm sorry, Russ, but they picked another actor to play the part of Tony, but they've offered you the role of Riff. And I said, Riff? That never even occurred to me, to play the part of Riff. And he said, so, do you want to do it or not? And I said, yes. So that's how I got started. And oddly enough, the first thing that Jerome Robbins said to me was, he said, now, Russ, I've seen all your movies, and I've seen you jump all over things and do acrobatics. But he said, in West Side Story, Riff is straight dancing. There'll be no acrobatics at all. And I said, okay, I'll do my best.
So there's one story, a big number in New York toward the end of your time there in New York at what is now Lincoln Center. And then you guys do it, and Robert Wise thinks it's great, and you guys nail it, a big number. And then, but Jerry wants to have everybody do it the other
foot.
on the other.
If you're a dancer, you don't know how hard that is. You know, to do like a tergite and do all these dance steps down the street. I could barely do the ones that in the one way, you know. But we went all the way down the street, and all the dancers are going crazy. So it took forever to learn how to do it right, you know, on the other foot.
Nobody'd rehearsed this, right? It was just...
No, this just happened when we were in New York. It took a lot of time, and he took a lot of time, but who's going to argue with him? He was a great choreographer and did some good things.
But you and Rita have said that he was tough. George Chigiris is a little... He's more gentle in his memories.
But
you and you and Rita feel like you're being honest, that he was really tough to work for.
Oh, he was really tough. I had a big argument with him, oddly enough, the first time I had a line.
You have the first line of the movie.
Yeah, I think it was.
It is. You have the first snap.
And it wasn't.
And the first line.
It wasn't even.
Yeah.
It wasn't even a line.
Right.
It was just a grunt.
Right.
It was I come face to face with George Chigiris, who was Bernardo, and my line was, like that, you know? And so I did it, and then Jerry came in and said, no, Russ, he said, it's like the end of in the music. You gotta understand that the music goes, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da- I understand how it was done on the stage, but this isn't the stage. This is a camera right in my face, you know, and they're shooting. And I said, I'm not going to look in the camera and go, ha! You know, this was silly. And so we argued about it. We walked down the block arguing about it. And he was saying it was the way and part of the music. Finally, Bob Wise came and said, hey, listen, you know, we got to get working here. The time's going by. He said, listen, why don't we shoot it both ways? We'll shoot it both ways and then figure out which one's best. So I did it both ways, and they ended up using mine.
Yeah, that's right.
And thank God.
And there's a lot of stories about this, the production of West Side Story. Some of them seem true. There had been some trouble with, I guess, gang violence on a previous picture. I think a Burt Lancaster movie, probably The Young Savages, I think.
Yes, that's true.
And so did you guys hire gang members to...
Yeah, we did. We hired a gang to work on this one block, and the gang worked the whole block. And then something happened. Somebody came on the set that they didn't like or something, and he got knifed. And so it was pretty, you know, it was pretty crazy.
Evidently they were tough, legitimately tough.
Oh, they were legitimately a gang. And in fact, I remember that one of them came over and said, "How can I join the Jets?" He was one of them. He wanted to be. And I said, "Whoa, you know, we're just actors. This is, you can't really join. Can you dance?"
Yeah. I think every gang member at heart would like to put away their knives and wear a windbreaker. Yeah. Which is the true sign of a tough gang, is a beige windbreaker. So how did West Side Story change your life? Like, it must have been different for you.
Yeah, it was probably the biggest, most successful movie that I did, and gave me a lot of clout. I traveled with it around the country, not only around the country, but to England and we went to Belgium and Paris, France to premiere it. And in England, we did a Royal Command performance, and Queen Elizabeth came. And in fact, I have a story that she came and we met her on stage. And then we all, not all, but I guess several of us came up and sat up in the royal box. And it could have been all of them. I can't remember. But Queen Elizabeth was sitting right in front of me, and Peter Sellers was sitting right next to me. And the music came, the overture, and Queen Elizabeth was like right in front of me and sitting in this chair. And the music, and then suddenly the curtain started to open and the theater started to darken. And Peter Sellers leaned over and said, "Lady, would you mind taking your crown off?" Yeah, that's a classic. And I thought, you know, and I looked at him.
Is that true? That's a true story? Yeah. Oh my God, that's good.
And I looked at her, you know, and then I just looked at her from the back and she didn't budge, just straight faced. And I knew she heard it because I heard it. Had it right in his ear. And so when we were leaving, I asked Peter, I said, "Peter, how could you have said that to the Queen, you know, to Queen Elizabeth?" And he said, "It's all right." He said, "I always say something funny to her." He says, I have lunch at the palace and I say something and she'll say, "That was very funny." You
know? "Hey lady, would you mind taking your crown off?" That's pretty great. So, but then after a time you became, you didn't quite stop acting. But I was about to suggest that Twin Peaks is a return to the mainstream, but I don't think anybody working for David Lynch is really returning to the mainstream.
That happened by accident. I was living with Dean, and Dean said, he did a movie. He did the movie, can't remember the name of it now, but he did the movie before.
Blue Velvet, yeah.
Blue Velvet, yeah. And so it was David Lynch's birthday, and I was living with Dean, and Dean says, "You want to go to the party?" And it was at Dennis Hopper's house, and so we went there, and...
That was a good call, yeah. Yeah.
And so we go there, David Lynch was looking at cards, and he opened up this one, and it was a picture of this guy surrounded by all these beautiful women, and he laughed, everybody laughed, and I was standing next to him and said, "Wouldn't you like to be this guy?" And honest to God, this is what happened. And I said to him, "David, what I would really love is to work for you sometime." And he looked at me and he said, "Next project." And that's the real Hollywood line. I mean, you know, but sure enough, the next project, my agent called and said, "David wants to see you, wants you to come in." And I came in and came to see him, and he said, "Now the part that I want you to do in this series is this crazy doctor." So we finished the interview, and I when I left, I thought, boy, that's the first time that a director has ever said the part that I want you to do. He didn't say the part I'm thinking of you for or anything. He said, "The part I want you to do." So that was quite thrilling. I hadn't worked in a long time, but I loved David Lynch. So I got the part of Dr. Jacoby, and I wanted to be as crazy as I could possibly be and stand out. So I went down to the Venice Boardwalk and I was walking along I was looking at glasses. They had sunglasses, so I thought I'll wear a crazy pair of glasses. And I looked at different colors, and I finally boiled it down to a pair of red sunglasses and a pair of blue sunglasses. And I was looking at them back and forth like that, trying to figure out which one I wanted to get. I said, "I'm going to get one of these." And then finally, I held them both up, and I went, "Ah, that's it. I'll have one red lens and one blue lens." And so I got the, I went and had them made for me. And I took him in to see David and said, "What do you think?" And he said, "I love it." He had his high voice. He says, "But," he says, "let's just not tell anybody why you're wearing them." You know? So that's what happened.
That's great. God, that's so good, going to Venice. That was so smart. So we're almost out of time. You're writing a book. It's coming out soon, right?
Yes, I've spent the last 25 years writing my memoir, and it covers everything. which is a lot of time. It's like, this is your life in this book. It's called Dancing on the Edge, and it'll be out next year. We're finishing it up now. I've got a publisher and Blackstone Publishing, and he's writing, and they're sort of editing it now. We do an edit, and then when you have a book, the publishing company edits and goes back and forth. And
I'm gonna end with something risky because I don't know the answer to this question. As you know, they tell lawyers, you know, never ask a question in front of a jury that you don't know the answer to. And this is the jury, and I don't know the answer to this question. But your co-author is here, right? What's her name?
Yes, she is. She is here. She's sitting back at the corner table back there.
All right. So she told me that you keep calling with, like, hey, did we include this story? And she'd be like, no, tell me that story. Like, there's so many stories. So she said you called and you said, did we include the Charles Manson story? And she was like, no. So here's the risk. What's the Charles Manson story?
Well, I was living in Topanga, and I picked up, and then I didn't know who he was, and I picked up Charles and two of his girls.
Really?
And he was staying up there, and I picked them up. I was living up at the top of this mountain, and next to Neil Young. But so I drove him up the hill and dropped them off where there was just rocks, and that's where they were sleeping out. And one of the girls said, "Do you know who this is?" And I said, "No." And she says, "This is like the new Jesus, and his name is Charlie." And I said, "Oh, great." So, yeah. And so, all the girls in the canyon heard about him, you know, and they said, "Oh, this guy's an idiot, you know, he's really, really dumb." So he got this big reputation of being this, this heavyweight guy, and a lot of people didn't. The people that I knew, anyway, thought he was nuts.
So you, yeah, well, usually, it's a fairly good rule that when someone describes themselves as the new Jesus.
Yes, that makes me right away run the other way.
That's a sign that that you need to get out of my car right now.
Yeah, well, that's what they're saying now about Donald Trump.
Yeah, well, that's Look at... Look at Russ Tamblyn putting a button on the conversation. The book will be out next year. Russ, you've given so many of us so much pleasure over the decades, 78
thank
years
you, Ben,
in this
and
business.
It's such a pleasure having you interview me.
Russ, thank you. Russ Tamblyn, everybody. Thank you.